ripping it off.
Hey, where's the phone booth?
I know, right?
Yeah.
I don't really have anything prepared for tonight. This is kind of an impromptu thing, but. Huh?
Suzanne already used that word with our guest coming in from
outside. But I was just looking for scripture to share tonight. And I feel led to this one, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 4 through 6. Such is the confidence that we have through Christ toward God. Not that we are sufficient in ourselves to claim anything is coming from us, but our sufficiency is from God, who has made us sufficient to be ministers of a new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life.
Yes.
You know, we've been talking this past few days about the hunger that's being, you know, awakening in the people around us. And I mentioned here Sunday that it's our duty to go out into this world when we see these people that are like lost sheep and you know, offer them our assistance in whatever way we can. In this case, it would be letting God speak to them through us and share our experiences, our testimony, and things like that. And, you know, I think not only we should do that for them, but we owe it to ourselves too, because it's a two-way street.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We don't know how that person's going to be blessed with what we share, but we also don't know how we are going to be blessed.
Exactly. Right.
So I encourage you to, you know, do that. Pastor and I were just talking, and one of the things that we were talking about is how we have the mind of Christ, and you know, we should know that whatever we share with other people that is edifying, to bring them back to the way, which is Jesus, it's because it's coming from Him, not because it's coming from us. Yeah. So let's just rejoice that we have been chosen to do this, because this is not a job. This is, yeah, exactly, a privilege. Yeah. You know, being chosen, and because God's basically telling us, everybody's important, you know, but I'm tasking you with this because I know that what I'm sending you out to do, you can accomplish me. You can accomplish it through me.
Yes.
That I strengthen you. So that's my little nugget of wisdom for tonight. Yeah.
That reminds me of something I just read. Because it applies to what we're
issue with public speaking up until a few years ago, because you know, I don't like to be the center of attention. I still get a little nervous on Sundays when I stand in here because there's more people. But I forgot my point. Sorry. The first time that I was tasked with leading worship, I did not want to do it. And that very Sunday that I was going to do it, before I left my house, I said, God, why do you want me to do this? And He said, because you are my child. And I started crying like a little kid when I heard that. But, you know, that's one of the biggest revelations that I've had in my journey as a Christian this past 2.5 years. You know, when God tells you something like that, you know, that carries on for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, I'm going to share some things on Sunday, and I was kind of planning on this already. And it's a letter that my mom's pastor wrote. It's an open letter that he wrote and posted on his Facebook page to all the fellow pastors over there, because they started this Monday another 40 days of prayer and fasting over in my hometown, back home. So I'm going to work on that. But the main idea of the letter is that we are in an emergency room in a hospital, and everybody around us is in need of some care,
mm-hmm.
and we have the tools to help them
yeah.
and heal them.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to translate that. I'm going to bring you on Sunday.
Yeah.
Back in.
Right. Just think of the confidence that God has in us.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly.
You know, I mean, I don't think we understand that a lot of times.
Right.
He's put this whole thing in our
hands.
I mean, that's everything he gave, everything he did, and he has the confidence to say, now you take it and run.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That's
yes.
amazing.
Yes, right.
Thanks. Thanks.
Thank you, God.
It's amazing how God revealed stuff to me. Like, my house is being so transformed, and I'm very thankful. And I remember, what's this against that? Three different things. Ask, seek, and knock. And that happened within a week.
Mm-hmm.
This is going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Because I paid attention to what she said.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, that opened the door.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sitting there like, wow, Lord, is it that easy?
Yeah.
When I met my iPad, I had broken my screen. And it was literally cracked. We were sure it was, well, we'll go to the regular place. Well, the other one place wasn't open. But the other place here wasn't open. I said, why didn't you Google on your iPad somewhere, or get onto something and point to a place. You know, it was open on 2nd Avenue. It's close to home.
Mm-hmm.
And how could that be? You know, still $100, I won't have to go out of my way to go get my iPad that's fixed. And I was going to worry over my iPad. Now, I don't have to worry when my iPad is fixed.
Mm-hmm.
I use that all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I use it for Google and whatever, and things to help people. It's helped me so much, and it's just a blessing that Jesus is within me.
Yeah.
Because if I didn't was worried over that, then it probably wouldn't even, it might have not happened.
Right.
You know, there's an example there that Christ is a light in all of this.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm realizing you're excited, but to be patient and just to just kind of listen and observe.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Right. All right.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Mike.
Thank the Lord for His Spirit moving Sunday night when like hearts gathered together to worship the King
mm-hmm.
of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I know we will be blessed from it. I know that they'll be blessed down there at New Life for that too. And just thank God for the opportunity and for us to be able to share our hearts with them. And a lot of people talked to a lot of us from down there, and it was, I didn't hear any issues, I didn't hear any problems. It was all
mm-hmm.
it was all just thanking the Lord and thanking us, it is a bonding, but it was also helping them to understand that there is hope, and His grace and mercy is sufficient. Just let it rise, just let it rise, just let it rise.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Right.
Yes, Jody.
I just thank God that He's constantly revealing. I mean, like Nathan said, He's always been the same.
Mm-hmm.
But yet, these little revelations that we come into, I just really feel like He's trying to get us to look into the spiritual realm of things, seeing
right.
it in, and as the Spirit sees it.
Mm-hmm.
It's been chaotic at work for the last, I don't know, how many months, I can't even say. But this week, I manage a Bosnian girl who's a Muslim, and she freely speaks about Muhammad and Allah, and you know, we talk about Jesus, and so anyway, so she's been gone this week, and I just feel this, like this freedom of
up to bring up the situation with the Muslim, and I knew of a situation, I heard of it last weekend, of a person being in your same situation. Yes, you can attack the spirit, you can stand up against the principalities and things like that, but help her understand who God really is.
Yeah.
He's my healer.
Yeah.
He's my provider.
Yeah.
He loved me. He died for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, none of these things that Muhammad did or any other God did,
right.
little g with no appreciation to it.
Right.
But anyway, this girl in time came up to this person and said, I need healing. You know, I don't know what to do, but I heard that your God heals. And naturally, the first thing the person wanted to say back to her, well, what about your God? Doesn't he heal? But didn't say that. And got healed, prayed for her, she got healed, and just then the confusion started in her spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And in time, she gave her heart to the Lord. The second time he prayed for her, she received the baptism of the Holy Spirit in the midst of receiving Christ in her life.
Right.
So, in her own way, she doesn't understand. There's still that void in her that only Jesus can fill.
Mm-hmm.
So she needs to be shown the demonstrations of what Jesus can do, not to brag on anything you know, that we've done, but what he's done through us and through others.
Yeah.
To show her the light, and then it'll start questions in her mind that only he can fill.
Right.
And just pray for that rain to come on of revelation and stuff like
that.
Yeah,
I do know that he's calling her, because every job she's been in, there's been a Christian in her path.
Mm-hmm.
And gave her a holy Bible.
Mm-hmm.
So now she's with us. There's like three other Christian ladies that work on the team, and we're always able to witness to her.
A cloud of witnesses.
And what's funny is when she's having her trouble, she will come to one of us to complain.
There
you know
is.
What I'm saying? So,
there is.
So before she left, she flew to Turkey. She came up and she hugged me, and I told her that I would pray for her. I mean, you know,
there it is.
The love. And she held me even tighter. So it's like, I know that she's got that unction.
Yeah.
I mean, God created all of us in his image.
Mm-hmm.
Just, she's been brought up this high
right.
to believe in something that's not real.
Just think about people that are just religious people.
Oh,
Muslims
yeah.
aside. Let's
yeah.
say Christian.
Right.
Are we really comfortable around them?
Yeah.
You know, when they're always kind
mm-hmm.
of measuring and,
yeah.
and they're always critical and hyper kind of
yeah.
negative about everything. Well, imagine what it would be like to exaggerate that even further
mm-hmm.
to a Muslim who they have no guarantees of heaven whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
It all totally works, and then it's a crapshoot.
Yeah.
Unless you're a martyr,
mm-hmm.
there's no guarantees. It's good works have to outweigh the bad works, and you won't know until it's all over.
Right.
So imagine living your whole life that way under that kind of pressure and oppression.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's only natural, you know, that you would feel that oppression
yeah.
when she's there.
Well,
that's what she must feel.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
So I would say the opposite is true, too, for her.
Mm-hmm.
There's probably a sense of, you know, a freedom that she doesn't normally experience.
There it is.
Right.
There it is.
Exactly.
That when she's away from there, and I imagine that's got to be really confusing for her, too, because she's got to be, you know, I mean, to deny her faith.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Suicide.
It is.
You know?
Yeah. Yes.
Not to mention, you become a total outcast
yeah.
to the whole family and everybody that you're connected with. So,
yeah.
it's, you know, it's a battle. I mean, it's a battle for them.
Mm-hmm.
And it is exactly what you said, Julie.
Yeah.
It's a spiritual battle.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's not about her. It's not about you. It's about the demonic forces that are at play
yeah.
trying to control and manipulate and
mm-hmm.
devastate everybody. You know, so.
Right.
prayer for my family. Not that there's something bad going on, but you know, I know God's moving because it's been quite a while, several weeks, that when I talk to my mom on the phone, she tells me that something bad's happening. I don't know, it's like there's this harmony now in the house, and you know, there's less yelling, less fighting, and things like that. There's some things that still need to happen with my sister back, the one that was here. But also for my nephew, I believe he's getting a revelation right now because something happened in school that he got removed from the worship team that he was in on Thursdays. But they didn't do it as a punishment, and they were very clear when they told him about it. They just said, use this time and spend it with the Lord so he gives you a revelation, because you are, how do they put it? You are a witness to all these people that are here at that very moment when you guys are doing worship in the platform. Mm-hmm. So you got to make sure that you stay focused on what you do and not steer away from some of these things that are going to make you look kind of like a hypocrite in a sense. But, you know, I'm just thankful that all these good things are happening back home. I know that some of those family members of mine that haven't flat out said, yes, God, Jesus, I accept you as my Savior, they're coming to that point because of the revelations that are happening.
Amen.
So, anyone else? Yes, Dan.
I forgot that one of the carriers in my building, his grandson is 3 months old, and I told him that we would pray for healing. He had to go to Iowa City. They're not sure if he can see. Mm-hmm. They're not sure if he can hear. It resembles something going on in the brain, like Down syndrome, but he doesn't have that. So I said, well, we'll just pray that, you know, babies grow and brains and all that grows quickly, that it just grows and it's just fine.
Yeah.
So I told him he would pray for total healing and that
total
his parents
healing.
Are fine.
Yes. Yes. Yes, Lord.
Anyone else? Okay, well, let's stand. Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight for your grace. We thank you, Lord, because you have cast us, you have chosen us, Lord, to go out into this world and spread your word, show people who you are, Father, so that you use
gave our hearts fully to you.
Yes.
God, that you will just magnify this time we have with you and multiply, Lord Jesus, the blessings as we rejoice in you. In the holy name of Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
History split by sacrifice. God's perfect Son gave up his life to ransom back the lost and damned, paying the price justice demands. As he was broken, heaven was open, our sins committed, our sins acquitted. His loving kindness is divided into the realm of grace. Sing a new song, sing of his goodness, sing of his faithfulness. As he was scorned and crucified, the Lord availed the brief divine, taking us from darkness to light. As he was broken, the heaven was open, our sins committed, our sins acquitted. His loving kindness freely invites us into the realm of around your throne. We cast our all distractions of this day. We cast off distractions of this day and focus on you alone, Lord. For you alone are worthy, Lord. You alone are worthy, Lord.
Worship team, hallelujah, great as always, praise God, thank you Lord. Thank you Jesus. Gotta just for your information, in case you happen to come by here Friday or Saturday, we're having a wedding rehearsal Friday night, and the wedding's at 2 o'clock on Saturday, so that's what's going on. It's not a kegger, not a blowout. It's at least I hope it's not. I don't know for sure, but no, it's going to be a wedding, and appreciate Mike is going to help me out with sound and stuff for this. So it's my son-in-law's brother, and to help them out, praise the Lord. And God is good. Thank the Lord. Praise God. I was talking to Roberto a little bit before church, and I was telling him I was going to teach a simple message tonight, but it's about the will of God. I hear, you know, all the time, especially people who don't really understand what this covenant of grace has provided for us, and there's always looking for the, people are always looking for the will of God, and you know it, but you don't know it.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Yeah. Amen. And, you know, people struggle with all sorts of things, you know, choices and jobs and different things, and always freaking out, waiting for God to give them a sign in the sky, you know, or a dream or something. And that happens sometimes. I'm not saying it doesn't. Sometimes God gives us witnesses, you know, in different ways. I've sought the Lord for those things myself, but it's not as complicated as we sometimes think. Praise the Lord.
That's the truth.
So, with that in mind, let's go to Psalms 143, verse 10. Psalms 143 and verse 10. Teach me to do thy will, for thou art my God. Thy spirit is good. Lead me into the land of uprightness. Praise God. Ephesians 5, 17. Just to give us a little context here. Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. Praise God. Colossians 1 and 9. For this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Praise God. Thank the Lord. I got to tell you, for the last, I don't know how many years, quite a few years, when I was first saved, I was always trying to figure out what the will of God was and looking for witnesses and, you know, signs and different things. And God was good to do it, because lots of times he condescends to our stupidity, praise the Lord, or our lack of understanding, you know. But the truth is, for many years, as long as it doesn't contradict the Word of God, I just do it and assume that it's the will of God. And I found that God honors that and blesses it, because he wants us to have the desires of our heart, as long as it doesn't conflict with his Word. And most of us know that, either in principle, if not verbatim, you know. I mean, we know that I'm not, you know, you're not going to get somebody else's wife or somebody else's husband, or, you know what I'm saying, you're not going to rob a bank because you need some money, right? But I'm just saying, so if you just use common sense, and then just move on what motivates you and what your desires are, you'll find that God honors that. God has given us a great deal of flexibility.
Yes.
Amen. But let's look at this. So we've been, the truth is, one of the reasons why we are this way, it's just like the reason why grace is difficult for a lot of people to embrace. For one, on the one hand, you've got the church kind of preaching against it, or at least giving us a mixed message about it.
Yeah.
And the other thing is that the culture that we live in is just based on this kind of not knowing for sure this or that and trying to figure everything out. So we've been raised, if you think clear back to when you were a baby, Tammy brought, which is our great-granddaughter, over the other day, along with our granddaughter, the mother of that baby. And, you know, ever since you were a little kid, you start out with this playing peekaboo. It's like a little guessing game. Boo, boo, you know, who's that, boo. And so it begins with this peekaboo, and then you get a little bit older, and then we're humiliated by this guess which hand's at hand. I do this with the grandkids all the time. You know, they're always wanting gum. They come to my house, first thing, the two boys especially, Popo, you got any gum? They want bubble gum. They want, I've got tape, gum in tapes. I've got it. And I don't chew bubble gum, but I do have spearmint, double mint, stuff like that around. They call that the spicy gum. So if I don't have the other, they want the spicy stuff. But they always want gum multiple times a day. So I'm always doing that. Okay, guess which hand? And of course, I always switch it, whichever one it's in. And so, nah, I'm sorry, you're not going to get any. But they do get it, but I'm just saying, that's what we do. And then comes hide and seek. Now, I remember when I was a kid, I had two older sisters and an older brother, and then I had two younger brothers. So this just goes downhill. We'd play hide and seek, and then you'd find out, you know, when it's your turn to hide, nobody's seeking.
Yeah.
They've all gone off someplace, and you're left looking, you know, like, why don't they find me? This is the great hiding place, you know. They just went off to go do something else and left you there. So now that we're way older, guessing games just go on. I mean, it's like trying to find the sock that isn't in the dryer. You know, it's always the one missing sock. Or, you know, should I buy a house? Shouldn't I buy a house? Should I buy this house or some other house? Should I buy a car or not buy a car? Should I get this car or that car? Or, you know, I mean, it's just, it just never ends. Or when should I buy it? Or should I buy it at all? You know, it just, everything becomes this guessing game. And as a result, a lot of people wonder if God is playing some kind of hide and seek game with them. You know, he's saying, you know, find me, but he's not going to let you find him. Amen. And so it comes to this kind of hiding game with the will of God for our lives. The good news is, Almighty God, the creator of heaven and earth, cares about the course and the trajectory of your life.
Yes.
It matters to God.
Yes.
Amen. And the fact that God has a specific will for your life is obvious just from the scriptures we've read, the three we read. And we could have read 100 of them, but there's just three that gives us a clear indication that God has a will for your life. Amen. And it's specific. But if God has a will for each believer's life, then how come so many Christians have such a difficult time finding it? Amen?
Amen.
Maybe it's because we and God have a different idea of what his will looks like. God's will could take one of three forms, and I'm just going to briefly go over these. First of all, you have God's sovereign plan. Sovereign simply means he reigns. It's sovereign. He's in charge, right?
Yeah.
So before God created the world, we know that he had a plan, and we know that we were included in it.
Yeah.
Christ was crucified before the foundation of the world. So he has this world plan, and it's planned out exactly how things are going to go.
Right.
Amen? Now, it's more than just knowing in advance how random events are going to turn out. God is in control, and all events operate within the context of his exact plan. Now, that doesn't mean bad stuff happens and that's God doing it. I'm just saying everything that happens is within the context of what God's sovereign will is. Amen? For the most part, though, God's sovereign plan is hidden to us. We don't really know what the future holds. We know, in general terms, we don't know the specifics of it, right? Right? We know that if we are saved, we're going to have certain benefits and so on and so forth, but we don't know, you know, what's going to happen next week or tomorrow, or, you know, he doesn't say, you know, when you're 40, buy this house and spend X amount of dollars or do this or do that, right? But he knows. He knows about it. So the Bible tells us just a little bit about some future events, but he has told us just enough to assure us that he's in charge. Just enough to know that he's got control. Amen? God doesn't expect us to understand or even to totally discover this sovereign plan. Praise the Lord. Okay, that's one. Two would be God's moral code. It's all, we're still talking about the will of God. So God has established a moral code for all of humanity. Amen? It's simply his standard of behavior and conduct, which is in the Bible. I'm not talking about rules and regulations. I'm talking about, in the New Testament, he talks about love one another. Love God, love your neighbor. That's the only commandment we've got, actually, in the New Testament. So we know that he has this moral code. And God isn't really into rules and regulations, but he's given us beneficial principles for living. It's like I heard a guy talking today. It's like the law, only we're not talking about the law for us, but I'm talking about the law just in general terms. It's just like when you have little kids, you don't just let them do anything.
Right?
Right?
Right.
You tell them, if you go out in the street, you're going to get a spanking. Because we don't want them to get run over by a car.
Right.
So they learn principles because of punishment. That's the way the law was given. The law was given because these people were spiritually dead. They had no discernment. They couldn't have the mind of Christ. They couldn't know, you know, really what God's will or purposes were for anything. So he gives them rules, and when they break the rules, they die.
Right?
Right? When you were growing up, your parents had rules. You have to do, you can't do that. Why? Because you didn't have sense enough to not run out in the street, or you didn't know enough about what the consequences were for certain behaviors, so they would paddle your butt or set you in the corner or take away some privilege or whatever. At some point, you get to a certain age where you don't need those rules anymore,
right,
because you know what the consequences are.
Exactly.
So you're able to control your own behavior, not by fear, but just good sense.
Sure.
Yeah. I mean, you know, you're not going to rob a bank because you know you go to jail,
yeah,
right?
Right?
You were told not to steal candy at the grocery store, and if you did, you got your butt beat and had to take it back and be humiliated, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm just saying that's the way, and that's kind of the way the moral code of God works. It isn't like God beating us up. He's just saying, look, there's consequences, and I want you to know what those consequences are, right?
Right.
So God wants us to know him. So God's general will for our life is based in there. And let me remind you something here. This idea that somehow God is, you know, out to get everybody, that he's going to hurt somebody. But the moral law, if you will, or the moral code that God has is for our protection.
Yes.
It isn't to make us feel burdened down with a bunch of rules. It's just that there are consequences in the natural world, not coming from God. It's not God's punishment. It's just that he knows there are certain consequences for certain things. And so he has that built into this. It's principles. It isn't the thou shalt not. It's the be careful if you're in this kind of a situation. So that's what we're talking about with the moral code. And then there's God's general will for your life. And again, I want to remind you that in the Scripture, these themes are clear. They're in the Scripture. They're not hard to find. Number one, God wants you to believe in Jesus.
Yes.
And accept him as your Savior, right? Look at John 3:16. For God so loved the world, right, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life, which is actually God life. That's the way that literally is translated, that whoever believes in him has God life. They're born again. They have the life of God in them. So as God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have Zoe life or God life. Amen? All right, 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is longsuffering to us. We're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That's the general will of God. He doesn't want anybody to be lost. He wants everybody to be saved. Amen? Number two, God wants you to know him, and he wants you to know him better and better, and to submit to him. Look at Colossians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. Now, submitting to God is submitting not in servitude or in fear, but submitting to his way of doing stuff. So when we talk about submitting to God, we have to understand we've got to submit to grace.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah.
If you're not submitting to grace, you're not submitting to God. You're in rebellion against God.
Right. Yeah.
Praise the Lord. So for this cause, we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
All right. So, Micah chapter 6, verse 8. Let's look at that too while we're here. Micah 6, verse 8. He has showed thee, O man, what is good, and what doth the Lord require of thee, but to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with God. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Okay, number three, God wants you to be like Jesus.
Yes.
Now, when we hear that, we start getting nervous because we think, okay, now who's going to be like Jesus? He was God, right? Again, we have to understand the context in which God is saying this. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 6. He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also to walk even as he walked.
Mm-hmm.
How did Jesus walk? Totally trusting in God, in his grace, understanding that he was his beloved Son, in whom God was well pleased. So, okay, now within these parameters, I can say God's will for your life is you have a growing relationship with him that makes you more like Jesus.
Yep.
Right.
That makes you trust God more, that makes you confident of his love, his protection, and his provision.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So, grace, because of this, I can say that, because grace and truth came by Jesus.
Yeah.
So the will of God is for us to live in that truth by grace.
Yes.
Amen? God's intention for you is to be engaged in the process of becoming more Christ-like. That's God's will for your life. To know that you're loved by God, to know that all things are going to work out, that whatever you do, whatever you put your hand to will prosper, that God will, whatever you put your hand to will prosper, as long as it's within these parameters, within this context of what God has described. We're searching for the little details, and it's not necessary.
Exactly.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. At its core, God's will is not about a place or a thing, or a time.
No.
That's where we get screwed up. We think it's these specific little details when it's not. Amen.
Yeah.
Romans chapter 9 and verses 30 through 33. Romans 9, 30 through 33. Because otherwise, when God says, to whom the Son sets free is free indeed, and that he has given us the spirit of liberty. There isn't much liberty if you're always freaking out about every decision you make and it's going to be the wrong one. God's going to punish me. Something bad's going to happen now. We're going to go broke. We're going to lose this. We're going to lose that. You know, the kids are going to run off and go crazy on us, or, you know, who knows what. What shall we say then that the Gentiles, which followed not after righteousness, now get this, the Gentiles didn't follow after righteousness. They weren't doing any of the law. They pertained to righteousness, even the righteousness which is of faith. Praise the Lord. But Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, hasn't attained to the law of righteousness.
Right.
Wherefore, or why? Because they sought it not by faith, but as it were, by the works of the law, for they stumbled at that stumbling stone. As it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense, and whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed.
Yes.
Praise God. Amen. All right, look at chapter 10, verse 10 of Romans. Romans 10, verse 10. Just for the sake of time, I'm passing up these other. But for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
God's will is all about the condition of your heart,
mm-hmm. Yes.
Your spirit.
Yes.
And we overlook that fact. And I hear it even in our services where people are freaking out about, what do I do about my job? What do I do about this relationship? What do I do about this? Now, I'm not minimizing the importance of those things. I'm just trying to get us to understand you have way more control and authority in your life than you realize.
Yes.
Amen? And so we overlook that fact that God has given us his will to be done in our life.
Yes.
Amen? And that it's all about the condition of our spirit or the way we relate to God than it is about any time or place or thing.
Yeah.
Amen? So we overlook that when we realize God's will by thinking that it primarily applies to making choices, like between job offers. Oh my God, what am I going to do? I got this offer, I got that offer. Which should I take? Take the one you want.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? Amen? It's not about God's will focusing on a particular choice between that house and this house up the road.
Right.
Or this car or some other car.
Exactly.
The car that trips your trigger is the car that you ought to be getting. That's the car that
he wants to give you.
He wants you to have because it's the one you want, right?
Yes.
Right? I mean, again, within the car. I mean, you're going to go steal somebody's car down the street. But if you want a particular car, that's the car you ought to get.
Exactly.
Praise the Lord. Don't get hung up on seeking divine direction, amen, between donuts and bagels.
Yeah.
You go to Hy-Vee and you're looking at all these things. You go, Lord, what should I get?
Yeah.
Donuts, bagels, cinnamon roll. And you know all the time what you want. That's what God is saying. Go for the cinnamon roll. Go for the sticky bun. Praise the Lord. Go for what you want.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Right.
We've made it. I mean, I've said this before, but I came from a background of a church where, I mean, people wouldn't do anything without the approval of the pastor because they were so afraid they were going to miss the will of God as if the pastor knew what the will of God was for them. God's will is more about your character than about making choices. If you're going to get all freaked out and upset and mad at God because you can't find his will, what's that tell you?
Yeah.
It tells you something's haywire in the way you're thinking.
Yeah.
Because God wants you to have the desires of your heart.
Yeah.
Amen? That's the will of God for you. Amen? It's people get attitudes about these things and they get all depressed and bummed out, and morose, and they're dragging around, and oh God, I don't want to do this, and I don't know what the will of God. Just, man, do something.
Yes.
Do what you want to do.
Yeah.
Trust God.
Yes.
Amen. Your relationship with him is not about rules.
It's not.
Okay, try to comprehend the freedom that God has given you and the confidence he has in your decision-making ability when you trust him. I mean, this is awesome. The creator of the universe. Now, think about it. If you go back to Adam, you can see this playing out. He said, Adam, I'm giving you authority over everything. Name the animals. Whatever you say they are, that's what they are. Right? Just have at it. It's yours.
Yeah.
I've given you authority over everything. Everything that flies in the air, everything that crawls on the ground, everything, period. You have authority.
Yes.
Amen?
Yeah.
You just have to trust God.
Exactly.
If you're always making decisions and then fearful of what the outcome is, that's saying something about your faith or your trust in God.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, look at this in Romans chapter 8. We'll read verses 28 through 31. Romans 8, 28 through 31. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we then say to these things? If God's for us, who could be against us? God wants you to be free to make choices.
Amen.
And not be freaked out about everyone that you do that's going to bring some great calamity or catastrophe.
Yeah.
He knows the end from the beginning. He predestined you.
Yes.
He knows even the choices that you will make. Even if it's a wrong choice, it won't be a wrong choice.
Mm-hmm.
It may look like a wrong choice, but it'll become a right choice.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
He'll make it out for your good. I mean, look, I'm just saying this because think about getting up every day and not having to worry about every little thing, if this is the will of God. I'm not saying that you all do that, but there are some things that we really get anxious and uptight about and all, you know, fearful. And I'm just saying, man, just live your life and trust God.
Amen.
Do it.
Amen.
Enjoy it.
Yes.
Go for it.
Yes.
Praise
yes.
the Lord. God is not some power-hungry celestial tyrant. Amen. Who is so dictatorial, amen, that he wants to tell you every move to make. He doesn't. He wants you to have the freedom to make choices.
Yeah.
Praise God. He leaves us a lot of decisions to make.
Yeah.
Just to make ourselves. The freedom God gives us to make decisions is based on who he declares that we are. He's declared us to be his sons, heirs, and joint heirs with Jesus Christ, equal with Jesus.
Yes.
And he to say that and then to take away our ability to make decisions would be contradictory.
Right.
Yeah.
So he's saying, I see you just like Jesus. Go for it.
Go.
You make the choice. You make the decision. Mm-hmm. That'll be my will.
Come on.
Right?
Yeah.
Jesus said, I only do my Father's will. He wasn't freaking out all the time whether this is going to be the will of God or is that going to be the will of God. Who is he going to find out from?
Yeah.
He just did what he knew was within the context of what the scripture said, and he just went for it.
Amen.
In the face of all the religious arguments and persecutions and governmental and everything else,
Amen.
He just knew that God was going to back him up.
Amen.
That God would bless the decision that he made. Amen.
Amen.
God describes himself in Scripture as our King, our Father, and our Shepherd. Now, if you think about it, each one of those are people in charge.
Right.
People who have control, who have power over either their subjects, their children, or their sheep.
Yeah.
Right? So if you use those analogies with all this power, you would think that God would not give us a lot of decision-making ability. But it's just the opposite.
Exactly.
He relinquishes his ability to control and gives us the freedom to make these choices. In spite of this awesome power that he has, he said, go for it. I'm giving you authority.
Yes.
Amen.
I'm giving you the right to make choices. And even if it's the wrong choice, don't freak out about it. I can still make it a right choice. I can make the results of that wrong choice a positive. We are so worried that what that tells us is that we're really not trusting God. We're trusting in our own wisdom, in our own ability to discern. Most of the time, we can't know. Because we don't know, okay, I'm going to buy this house, right? What if the economy goes belly up? You don't know what it's going to do a year from now. We don't know what it's going to do tomorrow. So should we all sit back and live in a tent?
No.
Until we have some way of knowing that everything's going to be perfect for the next 30 years?
Yeah, no.
No. God said, go for it. It's not a crapshoot. It's a sure thing.
Exactly.
If it doesn't work out, I'll give you a better house. I'll give you another house. I'll give you a different house. I'll make it work.
Yes,
I'll make it work out to your for your good.
Yes.
Amen. Now that is an amazing delegation of authority, an amazing delegation of freedom from Almighty God, saying, you pick it, I'll call it right. You make a choice, I'll say that's the right choice. If it's the desire of your heart and it isn't contrary to my will, bang. If it isn't contrary to the principles of my word, it's yours. Think in terms of prosperity alone. Of course, this would be true with relationships or anything else, but I'm just saying just in the sense of prosperity. We keep waiting for God to bless us, to prosper us. And he's saying, you have the power to prosper.
Yeah.
It's in your hands.
Yes.
I have given you the ability to prosper.
Yes.
You got to just go for it.
Yes.
You got to go against your own rational way of looking at things sometimes and trust God.
Yes.
Again, if it isn't contrary to his overall sovereign will.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. He's given us freedom. He's given us this great delegation of authority and freedom. And again, it goes back to what I said earlier. It tells us how tremendous his confidence is in us.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
He has given us his trust to make decisions. And then he backs them up.
Exactly.
Praise the Lord.
Exactly.
Amen. Praise God. Look at this. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. Last scripture. Well, one scripture after this, but Philippians 4, 6 through 8. We're just about done here. I'm seriously thinking about that place in the Caribbean. Roberto, I mean, I'm not talking about a week. I'm talking about buying the island. Praise the Lord.
That's not God's will because you have to stay here for us.
Yes.
Yeah. Well,
yeah. Can we go with you?
Well, it's that private jet won't be a problem. I can just back and forth, you know. Okay, but be careful for nothing. In other words, don't worry about everything.
Exactly.
But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Yes. Amen.
Praise God. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, these are all the sovereign will of God, the context in which he gives us his will.
Yes.
Whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't be thinking about what horrible results could come of this decision. Think on this.
Yes.
Stay positive.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Okay, verse 13. Same chapter, verse 13. This is the last scripture. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me.
Yes.
We take things out of context, and then we give up our authority. This is what Adam did. I mean, it's a repetition of Adam's failure. God gave him authority. What did Adam do? He gave it to Satan.
Yes.
We have authority and we give it to the bank.
Yes.
Or we give it to some, you know, loan officer or some, you know, somebody else. We give them the authority to determine what we're going to, what we're not going to do.
Uh-huh.
Or, just as bad, God has given us authority and we give it to the preacher. You tell me what the will of God is. If he accepts that, it's because he doesn't even know what the will of God is for himself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yep.
I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me.
Yes.
Amen.
That is the will of God for your life.
Amen.
Trust him and live your life
based
on his grace and his favor.
Exactly.
And you will be in the perfect will of God.
Yeah.
Amen.
Easy enough, isn't it?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Freedom.
It is.
Say freedom.
Freedom.
That's what he came to give us.
Yes.
Freedom. Amen. Not just in the knowledge of heaven, but freedom for this life. We have authority. Quit giving it to the devil.
Exactly.
Quit letting him dominate and rule and keep you down. And I'm not just talking about dollars and cents. That's obviously a major thing, but it's not the only thing. He does it with relationships. He does it with everything in our lives.
Yeah.
He keeps us in a state of confusion, and that makes you stagnant.
Yes.
Amen?
Yeah.
We need to be moving all the time. We need to be progressing. And you cannot do that if you're in fear, if you're anxious about every decision you make. Because even when you make a right decision, then you're in a turmoil for weeks and weeks and weeks until you get a result. You're freaking out and fearful.
Amen.
What happened to faith? What happened to believing that God literally wants to give you the desires of your heart?
Yes.
And he's given you the authority to make the decisions so that those things can happen.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
For that, he deserves a hand clap.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen, amen, amen. God bless you. Thank you, everybody, for being here tonight. And now you know something everybody else doesn't know. You can be free. Hallelujah. And we'll laugh at them for being in bondage. Praise the Lord. No, we won't. We'll set them free. Glory to God. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. There you go. And that's what I'm talking about. Don't worry. Be happy.